Hello, it's my pleasure to be with you today, and I will talk about the migraine pathophysiology and the CGRP era, which is a very important topic. And this is my disclosure. I'm talking to you from Egypt, and surprisingly, the ancient Egyptians had described migraine, and as we see here in this papyrus, this Egyptian doctor is trying to treat migraine in this patient by tying a crocodile around his head. The crocodile here is biting some herbs in his mouth, and he's trying by tying this crocodile is to treat the migraine attack. And this papyrus is not available in Egypt. It's available now in the British Museum in UK. And as we see here, migraine is the second leading cause of years lived with disability, according to global burden of disease. The key topics that I will cover today is the migraine theories, migraine pathophysiology, and the CGRP signaling pathways, and a closer look into the CGRP with the new era in migraine management and the unmet needs in migraine management, and finally the summary and conclusion. Let us to start with the migraine theory. We all know the old hypothesis of migraine pathophysiology being a vascular disease. However, there is no clear relationship between the headache and the diameter of the blood vessel. Sometimes we might have headache attacks despite the vessels are still constricted, and sometimes the reverse, the headache might be relieved despite the vessels are still widened and dilated. So the opposing theory of migraine pathophysiology being a vascular disease is the neuronal theory. The main opposing view that migraine is a neuronal disorder of the CNS. And we have many other theories that are complementing to each other in order to solve the migraine puzzle. As I will mention later on, that the migraine pathophysiology looks like a puzzle with many pieces that can be assembled together in order to understand the migraine pathophysiology. The CGRP theory is very important. The cortical spreading depression, which means that there is propagated waves of cortical activity starting from behind, from the occipital region, and getting forward. The serotonergic changes is very important. The dural neurogenic inflammation and the vascular theory as well. So there are many theories that are complementing to each other in order to assemble the pieces of the puzzle of the migraine pathophysiology. So now we'll start to talk about the migraine pathophysiology. As we know that the brain lacks sensory receptors, there are no sensory receptors in our brain. However, the brain receptors or the nociceptors are present in the dura mater and the pia mater of the meninges. And these receptors are originating from the trigeminal ganglion. If we have a rapid look into the anatomy of the trigeminal nerve, here we have the trigeminal ganglion, and here we have the trigeminal nuclei, the three nuclei, the mesencephalic nucleus and the main sensory nucleus and the spinal trigeminal nucleus. The spinal trigeminal nucleus, the long one extending from the pons down to the C2, and it receives pain from the whole side of the face and from meninges as well. So here is the trigeminal ganglion, and then after the trigeminal ganglion, the nerve divided into three main branches. We all know the ophthalmic division, the maxillary division, and the mandibular division. Here is the trigeminal ganglion from which the nerve divided into three branches. As we see here, this is the trigeminal ganglion, and here is the central projection into the central nervous system, into the nuclei in the midbrain and pons and medulla. And here is the meninges, and here is the blood vessels present in the meninges called the meningeal vessels. So it starts here with the activation of the meningeal receptors present here around the meningeal blood vessels in the meninges, and this underlie the distinctive throbbing pain of migraine. And then the migraine pain is transmitted through these nerves into the trigeminal ganglion, and then the trigeminal ganglion transmits the pain signals into the brainstem, into the pons and the spinal trigeminal nucleus here, in order to be transmitted into the thalamus and then to the cortex. So the ascending axonal projection transmits these signals into the spinal trigeminal nucleus. So start here in the meningeal receptors, then it travels back to the trigeminal ganglion, and then to the spinal trigeminal nucleus or trigeminal nucleus caudalis present here in the medulla down to C2, and then to the thalamus and then to the cortex. And these connections underlie the characteristic features of the migraine. So to revise again, the pain starts here from the meninges back to the trigeminal ganglion, and then to the spinal trigeminal nucleus, and then to the thalamus, and back to the cortex. This diagram is a very brilliant diagram that illustrates the pathway of pain and the role of CGRP in the transmission of pain. And as you see here, this is the trigeminal ganglion, and this is the meningeal blood vessels. Here we can find receptors for the CGRP, and here also we can find receptors for the CGRP, and centrally here the trigeminal nucleus caudalis. Present here we can find CGRP receptors, and also centrally in the thalamus we can find CGRP receptors. Rapidly we can revise the pathway. It starts here from the nociceptive receptors present in the meninges, then back to the trigeminal ganglion, and then back and centrally to the trigeminal nucleus caudalis extending from the pons down to the C2, and here the trigeminal nucleus caudalis will send the impulses to the thalamus and then back to the cortex. This is a schematic representation of the transmission of pain, and this is the algorithm of activation of trigeminal vascular system of the trigeminal ganglion that lead to release of CGRP and substance P from the peripheral nerve terminal. So the activation occurred firstly here in the trigeminal ganglion. It will lead to release of the substance P and CGRP from the nerve terminal around the blood vessels that will lead to vasodilatation of the blood vessels with extravasation and mast cell degranulation here of the pro-inflammatory substances present here in the mast cells that will lead to activation of the neurons, activation of the nociceptive neurons that will go back to the trigeminal ganglion and then back to the spinal trigeminal nucleus and then to the thalamus and then to the cortex. So the sensitization starts first in the peripheral nerve terminal, and then it will be transmitted into the central nervous system, leading to the central sensitization, which means that we are sensitized to pain signals more than ever before. And This central sensitization is responsible for the following. Responsible for the longer lasting pain, for the more severe pain, for the easily triggered pain, and for the pain triggered by stimuli that are normally non-painful, which is allodynia, perception of non-painful stimuli as painful. The question now, these events all are happening in the dura. How can we explain that the pain can be transmitted to the face or the scalp? Because sometimes we hear from our patient that they are feeling some pain here in the scalp. They cannot comb their hair. This is because of the dura and face interconnection. As we see here that we have dural nerves that are interconnected into the facial nerves. So there are some sort of connections between the dural nerves and the facial and scalp nerves through the sutures. The question now, we start the pathophysiology with the trigeminal ganglion. Activation of the trigeminal ganglion will lead to release of substance P and CGRP from the nerve terminal that will lead to vasodilatation, and vasodilatation will and degranulation of muscles and release of pro-inflammatory mediators that lead to neurogenic inflammation that will be perceived by the peripheral nerves and back to the trigeminal ganglion and then back to the spinal trigeminal nucleus and then up to the thalamus and then to the cortex. The question now, what is the cause of activation of the trigeminal vascular system of the trigeminal ganglion? The answer is the hypothalamus. Hypothalamus is the main drive for activation of the trigeminal vascular system through activation of the trigeminal ganglion. So the hypothalamus with other brain areas are responsible for the trigeminal system activation. So the hypothalamus is responsible for the premonitory phase of the headache, and then the trigeminal vascular system is responsible for the attack progression and the migraine attack itself. This is a very brilliant diagram that describes the headache with all of the component of pain and nausea and vomiting and limited activities and disability are caused by the activation of the trigeminal vascular system. However, the premonitory symptoms like craving, like fluid retention, like heightened perception are caused by the hypothalamus, while the aura caused by the cortical spreading depression. Cortical spreading depression is responsible for the aura in the form of visual changes and speech difficulties and confusion and numbness. They are all attributed to the cortical spreading depression. After resolution of the headache, we have a postdrome manifestations like hangover, anorexia, and tiredness, and diuresis. They are all triggered by certain triggers, and the triggers are governed by the multi-factors like the genetic predisposition and the environmental factors that can help to trigger the migraine cascade and the migraine attack with all of its components. As I mentioned, migraine pathophysiology is a puzzle. With multiple pieces. Each part of the puzzle can be explained by one of the theories of migraine. Like, for example, the cortical spreading depression can explain the aura. It cannot explain the headache itself, but it can explain the aura. Also, the trigeminal vascular system activation, it can explain the headache itself, but it cannot explain the aura or the premonitory symptoms, for example. That's why the complementation of these theories together will help us to understand the migraine pathophysiology puzzle. If we go into the CGRP signaling pathway, as you see here, that the CGRP receptors are present everywhere along the migraine pathophysiology pathway. Here around the meningeal vessels and here at the trigeminal ganglion and here centrally in the brainstem and the thalamus as well. CGRP is responsible for the vasodilatation that occurred in the meningeal vessels. After activation of the trigeminal ganglion, it will send impulses to the peripheral terminals that will release the CGRP from their nerve terminal in order to be released into the meningeal perivascular space, leading to vasodilatation of the blood vessels. CGRP is not only involved in the process of the vasodilatation only, but also in the process of neurogenic inflammation through the degranulation of the mast cells and release of the pro-inflammatory mediators that will lead to neurogenic inflammation in addition to the vasodilatation. If we have a closer look into the CGRP, CGRP was discovered in 1982 as the alternative transcript of the calcitonin G. And as we see here, it is composed of 37 amino acid neuropeptides widely distributed in the central and peripheral nervous system, and it is potent vasodilator, as I mentioned. And it is involved in the trigeminal vascular system and the cell bodies in the trigeminal ganglia and the thalamus as well. This is the CGRP, and here is the receptor for the CGRP called the CGRP receptor complex. The CGRP receptor has three components. The CLR, which is calcitonin receptor-like receptor, this blue part, which is seven parts, and the RAMP, which is the green part. This RAMP is responsible for the ligand specificity. This green part makes the identity of the receptor and the specificity of the receptor to the CGRP as a ligand. And the third part is the RCP, this part. The RCP is responsible for signal transduction into the interior of the cell. These are the three components again. This is the CLR, and this is the RAMP, which is responsible for the identity of the receptor and the ligand specificity. And here is the RCP, which is responsible for signal transduction to the interior of the cell. And as I mentioned, the CGRP receptor involved in multiple areas of the brain, as I mentioned, around the trigeminal ganglion and around the peripheral terminal of the trigeminal nerves and around the thalamus and cortex and brainstem as well. And because of this peculiar distribution, CGRP is an important target for treating migraine and for hitting the migraine pathophysiology. As I mentioned, it is distributed here in peripherally and centrally and around the trigeminal ganglion as well. That's why CGRP receptor was targeted with the anti-CGRP and the anti-CGRP receptors. The anti-CGRP, which is directed towards the ligand itself, and the anti-CGRP receptor, which is directed towards the receptor itself. This was the theory of the CGRP. If we move to the clinical evidence implicating CGRP in migraine pathophysiology, we will find many studies that had found that CGRP is elevated in migraine, and CGRP here can trigger migraine if it is injected intravenously over 20 minutes. CGRP was found to be a potent vasodilator as compared to the substance P. Trigeminal ganglion stimulation increases the CGRP in cranial circulation, as we see here, whether with aura, migraine with aura, or without aura, CGRP levels are increased in migraine sufferers. Also, the triptans, which suppress the CGRP release from the trigeminal nerve, as we see here, triptans acts on presynaptic 5-HT1BD receptors. These receptors distributed here prevent the CGRP from being released into the perivascular space. So by preventing the CGRP here, the triptans can do its action through preventing release of the CGRP into the perivascular space. And as we see here, that the olshagyptan, which is the first potent selective and non-peptide antagonist of the CGRP receptor, have shown to be very effective in treating acute migraine attacks. However, some of the agents of this group, of Japan group, has some of the issues like liver toxicity. If we have a closer look on the release of neurotransmitter from the motor or the sensory nerve terminal, we should revise some of the basic concepts of the release of neurotransmitters. As we know, this is a vesicle containing neurotransmitter A or B or any other neurotransmitter. It has to be docked. Docked here, docking means to be near to the nerve terminal in order to be close to the synaptic cleft to release its content of the neurotransmitter. However, the vesicles, in order to be docked here, it has to be bound to this protein called snare proteins, which is three components: VAMP, and SNAP25, and syntaxin. These three proteins have to be bound here to the vesicle in order to dock the vesicle into the synaptic, to the nerve terminal, in order to be very close to the synaptic cleft to release its content from the neurotransmitter. And this is the site of action of botulinum toxin. We all know that botulinum toxin has a role in treatment of chronic migraine. And the botulinum toxin, first, the Botox here bind to the receptor, to the specific receptor. And, it is internalized into the nerve terminal, and it is splitted into two chains, the heavy chain and the light chain, by translocation. And then the botulinum toxin start to bind to the snare protein, and the SNAP25 is to be cleaved by the light chain of botulinum toxin. That's why there will be a failure of docking mechanism of the vesicle into the nerve terminal and then to release its content. So it will be trapped without docking. That's why it will prevent the release of the neurotransmitter from the nerve terminal. I'm trying in this picture is to give an example of the docking mechanism. As we see here, this small boat or small ship that this man is trying to dock the ship here. And as we see, this is the snare protein, and this is the vesicle that will release its content into the synaptic cleft. And exactly the site of action of botulinum toxin. It will break these proteins. It will break this tool that will help to dock the ship. And this is the mechanism of action of botulinum toxin. However, we have a different mechanism of action for the anti-CGRP medication. The anti-CGRP molecules or monoclonals are working in a different mechanism. They are not working presynaptically like in botulinum toxin. They are either work on the receptor here or the ligand itself. Either they are bound here to the receptor or to be bound into the ligand itself. So they will act in a different style, in a different mechanism. They will act on the here postsynaptically after the neurotransmitter has been released from the ship, from the vesicle, after it has been released into the postsynaptic membrane, or it has been released into the synaptic cleft, it will be working at this site, not presynaptically like in botulinum toxin. We have many monoclonal antibodies, as we know, the ironumab, the ramanizumab, the calcinizumab, the eptinizumab. The main difference here is the ironumab is working on the receptor itself. We are now familiar with the CLR and RAMP1, which are the components of the CGRP receptors, while these agents are working on the ligand itself, not the receptor, but the ligand itself. And these are the results of phase 3 trial of the anti-CGRP monoclonal antibodies. I think the other lectures in this course will cover the results of the anti-CGRP monoclonal antibodies. And now I will talk in two minutes about the unmet needs and management. We all know that we are using the anti-epileptic drugs like the topiramate, the valproate, and with all of their side effects like cognitive impairment, like obesity, like hair falling, like polycystic ovary. And sometimes we are using the beta blockers with all of its side effects like the bradycardia or bronchospasm or erectile dysfunction in men. Also, the antidepressants like venlafaxine or tricyclic antidepressants with their sedative side effects. Also, the antihypertensive like candesartan, for example, with the side effects of cough, dizziness, and fatigue and hypotension. And the cyproheptadine, especially in children with migraine. We are all, as neurologists, are suffering from the lack of specific treatment for migraine. And I think now, after the CGRP monoclonals era, I think the landscape is changing very rapidly, and things will be changed over the next few years considerably in treatment of migraine. And now, to sum up, role for trigeminal vascular system activation in migraine Bach physiology starts first with the activation of the trigeminal ganglion that will release the CGRP and substance P from their nerve terminals, that will lead to vasodilatation of meningeal vessels with plasma extravasation and muscle degranulation and neurogenic inflammation that will fire back to the trigeminal ganglion and then to the spinal trigeminal nucleus, to the thalamus, and then to the cortex. CGRP is distributed both peripherally here around the vessels and around the trigeminal ganglion and centrally around the trigeminal nucleus caudalis and then around the thalamus. The CGRP is a potent vasodilator leading to vasodilatation, neurogenic inflammation, peripheral sensitization, central sensitization. And finally, we have the anti-CGRP. We have the anti-CGRP monoclonals like ironumab, fremanizumab, galcanezumab. The ironumab is the only one which is working on the CGRP receptors. The others are working on the ligand itself. And the botulinum toxin, which is working on the presynaptic vesicles by breaking the SNARP proteins and the SNAP 25, preventing the CGRP from being released from the nerve terminal. Thank you so much for your attention.